In the first months after Carmen left, I of course was too emotionally gutted and too preoccupied with getting Ava to preschool and bribing her to poop in the potty, changing Chet, bathing both of them in the evenings, and singing them to sleep at night to think about dating. The Playboy Channel was the closest thing I had to a lover. Satellite TV with benefits. I was fishing for sympathy about my plight with a wild friend when he suggested Cyberskin. I thought he was talking about internet porn, of which I was already familiar, until he explained that it was a space-age substance that was actually quite spongy and lifelike. I told him that it sounded like something they should pass out in prisons. It'll change your life, my friend, and save your wrist. Though there was a sex shop just minutes away, for weeks I could not bring myself to enter it. Finally, however, I did, and I bought the floppy rubber thing from a woman behind the counter who weighed more than I do. I can't tell you what she looked like, because I pretended to be hypnotized by the dirty floor at my feet. I even feebly tried to disguise my voice when I said thank you and hurriedly scooped up my change. Anything to make it harder for her to recognize me in a lineup, if the cops were ever looking to round up the neighborhood perverts, losers, and freaks. As soon as I got home, I buried the thing at the back of my dresser drawer. Now that it was safely secreted inside my house, I was actually very excited about our date that evening, after putting the kids to bed. Then I rushed off to yoga. I'm living in LA at the time. 2 hours later, I was driving home singing to myself. A few of the yoginis in class had been especially flirty. Maybe soon I wouldn't even need the thing that waited for me at home. And the class itself was an ass-kicker. Every part of me sweated. My eyeballs sweated. For the first time in weeks, my brain was pleasantly stewing in endorphins. I was persevering through what was so far the hardest test in a fairly hard life. I was proud of myself. Each day, I could almost feel the wound inside me closing just a little bit more. I opened the door to my house and heard Ava, my daughter, and her playdate screaming happily as Chet lizarded after them. When I came in, they all gathered around my knees like sheep. Carmen, my ex, was in the kitchen, my kitchen, chopping a hill of kale. Her newest obsession was raw vegan cooking, so she was using my kitchen to prepare food. I guess you can't call it cooking. For rich raw foodies, too lazy to chop up their own. As it happened every time I saw her again, ever since that night she first left, as soon as our eyes met, my stomach lava-lamped, and I had to look away or fall over. It was all so fucking hard. How could I pretend she was dead when here she was in my fucking kitchen 5 afternoons a week? I hurried past to take a shower. Trey, she began, speaking so quietly that at first I did not hear her. The girls were playing in your room and they found your thing. I took it from them, but on the counter, by the sink, far away from the chopped up kale and my soon-to-be ex-wife, lay my new spongy pink plastic pussy. If it were only sharp and pointy instead of springy and soft, I could have plunged it into my chest and instantly ended my humiliation. The girls were fighting with it, and added helpfully. A coherent verbal response eluded me. I marched the 40 bucks worth of silicone, or whatever the hell it's made of, out of the back door to the trash, then took the back stairs up to my room to begin our new lives apart. She had Doug, her white Rasta guru boy. I had been willing to settle for a lousy, rubbery cutlet. And even that was denied me. I'm a Zen Buddhist, not a Tibetan one. We're not supposed to believe in karma. But goddamn, if karma is real, then in my past life, I was Vlad the Impaler. I was Mister in the Color Purple. I was Ike Turner times 10. And I'll jump ahead a little bit to some more dirty parts. This is about 5 months later. I was invited by the Sundance Institute to fly down to Rio to teach screenwriting for a week. That city lives in my heart. Years before, I had taught myself Portuguese with Berlitz tapes, and then had found a Brazilian girl to and paid her $10 an hour to teach me for conversation lessons. My reward for my resolve was flying down to Rio and Salvador de Bahia for 2 weeks with Carmen. She liked it well enough, but I was smitten. This time, going alone, I did a lot, you might even say exhaustive research into how best a divorcee drowning in months of loneliness might get himself laid. If I did end up paying for sex in Rio, it would not be my first time. When I was 19 and about to begin my junior year at Stanford, I drove across country with a friend and stopped off at the Mustang Ranch to drop off my virginity. There, at the end of my teens, I imagined myself an American Sartre or Truffaut, being delivered from my intellectual timidity, loneliness, and despair into the vivid world of adulthood by a cynical yet secretly loving, unfiltered cigarette smoking and well-read fille de joie. Instead, my virginity was released in a trailer in the Nevada desert under a mural of a deserted beach, airbrushed in neon colors, very, very badly. I described the event precisely as it really happened in my second novel, Home Repairs. And I prayed Rio would be better. The valet parking finally gave the place away of this term I was going to, called Centaurus. I circled the block, still unsure if I had the courage to enter, and then did. A smiling older woman took my $200 and gave me a locker key on a wristband. I stepped into the men's locker room, which was luminously white and smelled of steam and lavender. Another smiling old woman, this one heavy and round, handed me a towel and some terry cloth slippers. I found my locker and discovered a short white robe inside. There was just one other man in the locker room, but was getting naked in front of the round old woman that embarrassed me. I had read that the spa was lovely and that the blog I had found encouraged one to enjoy it before meeting the women. I took a wet sauna and then plunged into a small indoor pool that must have been 20 feet deep. I dried off, put on my tiny robe, steadied my eyes in the mirror, and then stepped out into a dim corridor. I heard American house music coming from the smoked glass door in front of me. I held the handle before I opened it. Inside the club at first, I could not see, only hear. As my eyes adjusted, I realized that I was the only man in a room full of dozens and dozens of women in tight gowns and sharp heels whose skin tones span the entire range of human possibility. It was how I imagined the adult world to be when I was 14 years old. It was the Make-A-Wish Foundation for lonely divorcee guys. I was a space explorer, still trying to comprehend this wondrous new planet, when the prettiest woman in the place walked up to me and said, "Boa tarde, good afternoon." She introduced herself as Bia, and because she was so much prettier than all the rest, I assumed that she was the non-sexual hostess there to bring people into the club. Then she backed me up to the bar, reached into my robe, and grabbed my cock. I let out air noisily, as if from a balloon. She held my hand and led me out of the disco, down the quiet hall, and into a room with a round bed and a mirrored ceiling. She stepped out of her heels and unsnapped her halter, and her dress collapsed to the floor. I asked her to put her shoes back on, and she wagged her finger at me. I dove into this hour of condom-wearing sports sex with the gusto of an amateur adult film performer / director. There were no feelings to be hurt, no expectations of a future, no love to watch fade. There was just playful biology, geometry, and of course, physical education. Afterwards, she snuggled into my side and we breathed together. On the plane ride home, I would close my eyes and try to remember her smell. Thank you very much.